For the moment, let's shift our focus back again to the core of the government. And I would like to now invite the Secretary to the Treasury and Secretary Ministry of Finance, Mr. Sajith Artikala, to make his presentation on efficient government. Over to you.
Thank you, Manjula. Let me first congratulate the Chamber of Commerce for hosting this year's economic summit in spite of the disruptions caused by COVID-19. While it is certainly unusual to be speaking at this annual event remotely, it does not by any chance take away the fact I am honored to have been invited to be part of this summit. The topic under discussion is also interesting because the government, which has been in office just over a year, has just presented its budget for 2021 and is also challenging, especially given the level of unpredictability in the environment that has introduced to us lockdowns, social distancing, and now bubbles seemingly being the new norm. However, the budget 2021 presented amidst the COVID-19 is a budget of hope. It is a budget aimed at rebuilding an economy that has been on a continuous low and sluggish growth trajectory since 2015, with growth in 2019 at a mere 2.3%. It is not an acceptable rate of growth because it means that our children have been prevented from exploring the world in full. Our young men and women have been denied opportunities to try out new ventures and be entrepreneurs. It means our seniors have not seen anything new. It also means, perhaps more importantly, that we had not built up the required buffers, both financial and otherwise, to meet the exigencies that may arise, the case in point being the COVID-19 pandemic. To me, as an economist, it means that the country has been operating below its capacity, and it is certainly a matter of concern. Because it means, in a simple terms, the economy we have is full of inefficiencies at every startup, creating significant disparities in resource allocations, which could compromise national security and also create social unrest, the ramifications of which we as a country is no stranger to, and as such, I'm sure no one would want to experience that again. But what are the features of an efficient government? I think, to me, it is a government that ensures that there is less asymmetry of information, creating strong markets, policy frameworks that are a reflection of the ground realities due to strong political and bureaucratic engagement with the common citizenry, organization of government on clear, simple lines with few layers, an empowered bureaucracy with simple and modern processes that are useful in the present day context only adds to this. In discussing efficient government, I will primarily focus on the budget 2021 because the budget of a country indicates its strategy of resource allocations in achieving the objective that is so desired. The budget will give an insight into how the government aims to tackle the issue of efficient government at every level of the government machinery. The direction of the economy will be decided by the sectors to which resources are allocated. In designing a budget, key documents and the framework referred to are the government's policy framework, which sets out the clear developmental goals established through a dialogue with the citizens, and in particular, key priorities of the government. The organization of government at the central, provincial, and local government levels, and the statutory and functional requirements for resource allocation. Budgetary allocations will have to be provided for the central government agencies that will include the ministries, departments, and other institutions. Provincial governments are also provided resources to meet the gap between its revenue and expenditure. Local governments, although has its own revenue sources to meet its expenditure, are also supported through the budget. However, the bulk of resources are allocated to central government agencies, and its efficiency and effectiveness is dependent on how well the responsibilities of central government has been allocated amongst the ministries and departments. In this regard, the gazette, which was issued on the 20th August 2020, in establishing the basic structure of government has been very clear in its assignment of subjects and functions together with the reference to special priorities. The clarity in the terms of reference for the ministries and state ministries, as I would like to call, has facilitated the citizenry to craft their expectations accordingly. This has facilitated a more targeted allocation of resources with better trickle-down effect, making it easier for the achievement of the expected outcome. In an unprecedented move, the secretaries of the state ministries are also recognized as chief accounting officers. This is not only empowers the secretaries of the state ministries, but also creates better accountability for the resources allocated to achieve the ensuing objectives. The transparency and accountability that is established is fair by both the ministry and the stakeholder. Perhaps what needs to be acknowledged is that the political establishment has now articulated clearly their expectations coupled with deliverables, and it is now left to the bureaucracy to organize the resources, both human and physical, in a manner that facilitates the achievement of the TOR. The second aspect that is important in budget formulation is the government's policy framework, which is, in a democratic society, is built around its contract with the people. After all, it is the resources that belongs to the people that is being allocated. In this, I must note that a clear policy framework, rather than a number of policy frameworks or documents, supports a more efficient budgeting process. Therefore, the budget 2021 is built on the Saubhagya Dakma, that is the national policy framework of the government of President Gotabaya Rajapaksa. It is clearly spelled out vision with 10 key policies that gives priority to national security, includes an administration free from corruption, people-centric economic development, technology-based society, development of physical resources, sustainable environmental management aimed at achieving the fourfold outcome of a productive citizenry, a contented family, a disciplined and just society, and a prosperous nation. The resource allocations in the budget is aimed at achieving these 10 policies, ensuring a people-centric economic development, focusing on infusion of technology with a framework of sustainable environmental management. If one looks at the budget 2021, rupees 2.5 trillion is allocated to meet the recurrent expenditures of government, which includes salaries, interest expenditures, and subsidies. While the budget 2021 envisaged a public investment at 6% of GDP at rupees 1 trillion, this is almost double of the public investment of 2.6% in 2020. The public investment covers all sectors of the economy, and in particular is aimed at improving connectivity, both physical through a modern road network, for which rupees 350 billion is allocated, and also through the invisible connections of supporting a 4G telecommunication network around the country. Such connectivity, physically and otherwise, to markets will facilitate improved knowledge and less asymmetry of information. This allows the suppliers of goods and services to get a decent price, while the consumer is also allowed a range of options, creating a more democratic marketplace. It also facilitates government processes to be streamlined, improving delivery of services to the people. The budget also has allocated around 135 billion within an overarching policy of the government to provide clean drinking water for all by 2024. This was not only meet a basic human need, but also create a significant amount of efficiencies in the economy in terms of providing a healthier environment for our citizens. It is also noted that apart from the investments envisaged via the budget, there are other investments also activated over $2 billion, including the 600 megawatt LNG electricity generation project of the CEB, the development of the East Terminal at the Colombo Port, the upgrading and the expansion of the Bandaranaike International Airport, to name a few. It would therefore appear that not only the budget 2021, but also the government's investment strategy, already actioned and to be actioned, has been crafted to harness the dormant and the underutilized capacities of the economy by improving the efficient use of the resources within the country. But what of the structure that manages these resource allocations? That is, the government machinery. Has sufficient thought and resources been allocated to improve its efficiency? Perhaps the best is to refer back to the Saubhagya Dakma policy document. The chapter 2 of the document on the theme, An Efficient Country Free from Corruption, clearly spells out as to the government's thinking. It is quite lucid and so far that it identifies under governance four key sub-items: an efficient governance mechanism, defeating corruption, state enterprises management, and achieving unity through democratic governance. In this regard, I am also glad to note, as spelled out in the national policy document, which envisages updating of the existing rules and regulations in public sector to expedite the public service in a more efficient manner. We have already commenced re-examining the existing rules and regulations in the public sector, particularly the financial regulations, the procurement guidelines and mechanisms, and the land related laws. In fact, we have already issued a circular in August 2020 updating the financial regulations and merging provisions in 59 circulars. A new FR has already been drafted. It is expected to be issued before the end of the first chapter of 2021, first quarter of 2021. At the same time, having recognized the backlog in the court system and the requirement to update laws, we have allocated 20 billion in the next 3 years to not only update laws, but also introduce technology in court administration, and I understand also in court proceedings. I am happy to note that the budget 2021 was prepared using the Integrated Treasury Management Information System, or ITMIS, which was introduced in 2013, and I expect the full rollout to be completed by end 2021, which has been somewhat delayed due to this COVID issue. Already, there is a limited rollout of the e-procurement, and it is expected that before the end 2021, almost all the ministries and departments would have implemented e-procurement. This is not only efficient, but also has been correctly identified a mechanism to arrest corruption. Many have noted that the budget 2021 has placed a significant emphasis on the proliferation of technology and the use of technology in government systems and processes, while also supporting the private sector to invest in technology, as has been envisaged in the Saubhagya Dakma policy framework. The Information Communication Technology Agency, or ICTA as it's known, has been entrusted by the Presidential Secretariat itself to be the central point in the government IT program. This makes sense because I have seen many requests being made to the Treasury to implement various networking systems, oftentimes on a standalone basis. Some of these systems are a duplication of others, and some are a simple mechanization of a manual job that yields very little benefit. Even ICTA is the only entity that carries that level of capacities in the IT sector in government. Assigning the responsibility to ICTA to ensure that the systems in government attain a certain uniform standard and efficacy is the correct way forward. As such, we have supported ICTA by providing adequate resources to up its capacities. To that end, in the infusion of technology, government has focused on high impact actions, and two of the key activities are the ENIC and the RAMIS. Both these have the capacity to support the government to attain multiple objectives, including improved service delivery, may it be in importing a good, registering a motor vehicle, providing a more effective and efficient social security network, or fiscal discipline. The RAMIS system has been instrumental in supporting the government policy to have a simple and low tax structure and to ensure consistency of such policy, bringing in the much valued predictability in the business environment. The tax reforms of December 2019 are considered bold and necessary. There are two lessons in this action. One is that the government lost no time in announcing such measures, although they had been in office for less than 2 months. The efficiency with which the decisions were made created a business confidence in the country, which I suspect also pervaded even into the months that has followed with the pandemic. The second is that technology is vital in implementing change. When we reduced the VAT rate to 18 to 15, many predicted that the revenue will also halve during 2020, taking a linear view. I maintain that it will not be the case. Having high tax amidst a sluggish economy is inefficient and ineffective. It leaves no room for expansion. Clearly, it appears that revenue numbers reported to date indicate that we have collected nearly rupees 1.2 trillion so far. Mind you, this is within an environment of low imports, reduced activity due to COVID-19. We believe that this is partly due to the RAMIS being there, hence my faith in technology, and also because of the reforms introduced at the IRD with large taxpayer unit, and also perhaps at low tax rates, the payments incentive is high. Perhaps what is to me interesting is that we have managed to achieve almost 75% of the envisaged revenue in spite of the growth being negative. This begs the question, is the growth right? Because one cannot meddle around with revenue since it's either there or not. Having been privy to the benefits of technology infusion into public administration, that is why we have structured our investments now in the next 24 months to focus on technology infusion and rural roads as opposed to LRTs, because a rupee invested in a project that will support 14,000 rural villages to connect with the marketplace or support the collection of taxes more efficiently will create more growth and support better income distribution than a borrowed rupee spent on an LRT. Actually, our strategy will also create the fiscal space to support LRTs in the future. Let me also address a key issue that most of my colleagues in the neoliberal economic camp speaks of within the context of efficiency in investment. That is the so-called regressive move of an import substituting industry in the country through domestic industries is not in line with the simple Ricardian theory of comparative advantage. The concept of comparative advantage, to my view, should be dealt with caution, especially if the policies of that country, including trade policies, have resulted in creating the said disadvantages, as has been the case with the import of pepper, for example, at substandard levels. Then the issue is that it is the policy, not the natural endowment of resources, that has provided a false sense of comparative disadvantage against the country. Let me put things in perspective. The apparel industry has a US dollars 5 billion export base, while it also imports textiles to the tune of US dollars 2.9 billion. The industry itself requested the government to support the establishment of a textile park in Erawut. The government has provided the land and the basic infrastructure such as water, electricity, access roads. The investments, I understand, will be made by both the domestic and foreign private sector. And yes, it will substitute imports, but only because it is profitable to do so. So much so that we believe that at least in the medium term, this will generate a saving of US dollars 1 to 1.5 billion per annum, which fully justifies the investment. At the same time, in line with the best practices in international trade, we have removed tariffs from goods used for imports and rationalized the total tariff structure at not 10 and 15%. This is a more efficient tariff mechanism, and it also supports free trade better. Therefore, the decision to support domestic industries in the effort of backward integration and also their access to goods at a lower price are all part of the government policy to support efficiency gains in the private sector, so that they are able to have the comparative advantages to compete on a more equal footing with the world outside. I believe this is not a new phenomena, with most of the East Asian tiger economies also adopting similar strategies. I have so far spoken of the nexus between the budget 2021 and the resource allocation for efficiency improvement within the overall context of the government policies, including the organization of government structure. My premise is that we see today in government efficiency in decision making, in communication and establishment of goals, a government organized along simple and clear structure with responsibilities together with a robust accountability structure support the economic takeoff that is envisaged. Let me now move to my second part of the progressive state-owned enterprises. Progressive state enterprises. What is best at the outset itself is be able to define a progressive state enterprise. Is it one that is similar to a blue chip company that are shaped by commercial logic and rules of markets and competition, where social responsibilities are simply a marketing tool rather than a norm? Are we instead thinking of an entity that is able to comply with the rules of the market, but also be able to meet its social obligations as a matter of norm, even in times of market disruption? This definition is important because when one measures performance, it should be based on clearly defined expectations laid down by stakeholders. It need not be one that fits all SOEs either. For example, while the government has a reasonable expectation that the Lanka Swatrasa products are priced more reasonably than its private sector counterparts, it certainly does not expect any such favors from the Airport Aviation Company of Sri Lanka or the Sri Lankan Airlines, where their tickets could be priced at market prices. As such, already within the Treasury, having recognized the diversity of the entities and that a one-size-fits-all monetary mechanism does not facilitate these entities, we have clustered 52 of these enterprises as state-owned business enterprises, and 87 SOEs with strong commercial aspects are monitored by the Department of Public Enterprises and the Treasury, while 117 SOEs, which have been classified as non-commercial enterprises, are monitored by the Department of National Budget. The continuous loss-making status of commercial enterprises has been a cause for concern, and it appears that such losses are driven by the policies adopted by weak boards of management with little accountability, human resource policies that are outdated and is not a reflection of the requirements of the entity, resulting in either too many people and not enough in the right position, too much controls and too little autonomy, including a uniform procurement process that prevents responding or seizing business opportunities on time, low or no equity infusion again when it is required, and government direction that has not been consistent and pro-business. I believe it is for that reason that sectoral policies on state enterprise management has been included in the Saubhagya Dakshma policy framework, focusing on ensuring the accountability of the chairman and board of all state-owned enterprises, resulting in an efficient, profit-making and rational public enterprises. Hence, in December 2019, government, just month into office, in a very transparent manner, the presidential secretariat called for request for proposals, RFPs, together with CVs from interested qualified personnel. A committee led by the former secretary to the cabinet was appointed, which also included members from both the private and the public sector to evaluate these RFPs. This is an unprecedented move, given that every government since independence, regardless of their political views, adopted a very uniform process in their appointments to boards. Appointment political loyalists sometimes because of their ability, and oftentimes in spite of their ability. I understand that more than 10,000 applications were received, and it is fair to say that most appointments, especially to key entities, were made with great care. Effort was made to balance experience with young blood, professionals with entrepreneurs and industry leaders. And so far, we have found that there seems to be a significant improvement in the governance structure. I am by no means saying that all's well, but it may be fair to say that at least 60% improvement is more than acceptable when I am used to only around 20%. When boards were appointed in early January 2020, they were also requested to ensure that the organizational structure does not allow the position of an executive director when a chief executive officer or the managing director is already appointed. At the same time, in line with practices of good governance, the Treasury has clarified and determined that the position of the chairman of boards are considered to be independent, and the post of chairman and CEO cannot be held by the same person, breaking away from the commonly accepted practice. Perhaps to understand the SOEs, it is also required to understand the regulatory framework SOE operates in. While all the non-commercial enterprises are established under an Act of Parliament, the commercial enterprises are different in so far that of the 52 entities, 35 are established under a specific Act of Parliament or under the State Corporation Act of 1955 or the State Industrial Corporation Act of 57. The balance 17 are incorporated under the Companies Act. The SOEs established under an Act other than the Companies Act have within those acts sufficient autonomy to engage in the operations required to attain their objectives as stated in the Incorporating Act. This includes entering into agreements, hiring employees in quantity and quality they desire. However, the Finance Act number 38 of 1971 has curtailed the unfettered ability to engage in activities by bringing in an oversight function of the Treasury, focusing on mainly the management of finances. Therefore, the 1971 Act requires that the budgets of SOE should be implemented only with the concurrence of the Minister of Finance. This also extended to matters pertaining to investments, appropriation of net surpluses, borrowings as well. In fact, the Minister in charge of finance has been entrusted with even specifying the structure of the annual statement of accounts. At the same time, SOEs incorporated under the Companies Act do have the autonomy to decide on their cadre salaries and also their investments and operate within confines of the Articles of Association. However, again, various circulars and directions issued by the Treasury and sometimes by the line ministries have prevented these companies with state ownership from conducting their businesses operation comparison to a company with a private ownership. All right. So because I'm running out of time, I just want to emphasize the thing, although certain acts have allowed these SOEs to operate in a way or with sufficient autonomy, but again with certain acts it has been in a way constrained. So that's why in the 2021 budget, the Honorable Finance Minister Mahendra Rajapaksa clearly states that I propose to introduce a regulatory framework providing the required commercial freedoms to the public enterprises in various sectors. The need is clear. The current system envisages providing autonomy, but with a high level of accountability given its origin of public funds. Also, I just want to quickly note something that is in this new structure, what the government has identified, we have identified the opportunities in the market that the government decided to incorporate four companies wholly owned by ST with private sector presence in the boards of management. These companies, one is called Selendiva Investments, names are a little bit new, Sahasya Investment, Center for Robotics, and Sri Lanka Biotechnology Institute. Selen, I will briefly explain the structure of these. Selendiva Investments will manage and consolidate the government's high-end real estate assets, especially hotels, through the management and restructure of assets, including Grand Hyatt, Grand Oriental Hotel developers, that is Hilton, and prime land belonging to Sino Foundation adjacent to the Lotus Tower. More assets are expected to be vested with Selendiva. It is also expected that few entities will be listed in the market, hopefully before the end of the first half of 2021. Selendiva's role will be that of an investment firm. It will manage assigned investments of the government that include restructuring balance sheets and, if required, broad-basing the ownership structure, facilitating investors, both foreign and local, to invest in the country by providing end-to-end solutions. Then there is this expressway company where all the expressways and such assets, including the land that can be easily accessed through the expressways, will be vested to this Sahasya investment company. This company will also raise funds and manage the expressways, both existing and those yet to come. The other one is the Biotechnology Institute, that's called SLIPTECH, and the Center for Excellence for Robotics. Both are ventures of this government to open up our economy to new opportunities. Both this Biotechnology Institute and the robotic one will work closely with the private sector. SERA, or this robotic one's collaboration with the private sector, is expected to provide the required solution, mostly to improve productivity. So we have, have broad-based the structure, the normal structure of the government, the SOE structure, and also we will be planning a new FR, which will give the autonomy to these SOEs. That is to break the limited or in a way controlled the background or controlled the environment the SOEs are having, because we have the management improvements have been done, so we have to give that management some autonomy to work, so that really the budget has envisaged that, and we will be working towards that end, because my time is, I had some more to go through, but I will stop at this my presentation now by just telling these final words, we live in a very extraordinary times amidst the global pandemic. It is a time that is testing our patience, our capacities to endure, but it's time of hope. It is also time of new opportunities. So in conclusion, let me wish you all good health and hope, while also wishing the Chamber of Commerce the very best in its future work. So I will take up any questions if you have, and I will stop at this. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sajit, for that excellent words, particularly where you articulated what efficient government means, and particularly the role of the budget as a tool for resource allocation. And also you highlighted the important role that has been placed upon the state ministries, which have been brought to the forefront in driving the implementation process. Then also you went on to talk a lot about the importance of technology as a key driver of change, and also made numerous comments on state-owned enterprises as well, so which probably we will be revisiting during the course of the discussion.